This is Truth Frequency Radio.
The wicked ones, obviously under heavy Masonic influence.
The grand deception as Matrix is all-encompassing, consuming, and broad-reaching, yet so covert in imposition, it is largely unnoticed by those born into its nurturance. What if all we thought we knew of truth was sequestered upon lies, carefully manufactured science, craftily complicated algorithms meant undecipherable, comfortable in deceit and the convenience of routine? Most reject truth when confronted by it. People do not like being told that they have been bamboozled, especially by those systems they have invested trust within. Few will latch on to anything that challenges or contradicts their foundational belief, choosing to cling to false illusion, so long as either it is majority opinion or someone they admire perpetuates the lie. Fewer are willing to embrace change, having no real concern for truth, and as such, will not put forth the least bit of effort to its discovery. Many disregard it as meaningless until it affects them directly, and even then, it is a monumental task to change mindset and embrace new perspective. Most have tendency to lash out immediately against anything or anyone that challenges what they think they already know. Thus, the seeker of lost paradise may seem a fool to those whom have never sought the other worlds. Welcome, friends. I'm your host, Zen Garcia. This is Secrets Revealed, and we've got some of those to reveal today, for sure.
Giving up the secrets.
Right, yeah, we are definitely giving up the secrets. But, of course, I have as co-host Cathy Dunson. Cathy, are you there?
I'm here, and I wanted to say, while you were reading, I was thinking of the movie The Matrix and how perfect that displayed in a, a modern movie what we've come to now as truth seekers. You know, the red pill, are you going to take the red pill, or are you going to take the blue pill? And a friend brought up recently, you know, how many people really wish they could be like Cypher when he met with Agent Smith, and he wanted to be put back in the Matrix. You know, he was sitting there eating his steak and saying, you know, I know this isn't real. But I can taste it. I just, will it still be like that? Will it be like that? Just put me back in. I don't care. You know, who really wants that, though? I wouldn't want that. I want to know the truth.
Yeah, me too, at all costs. And, yeah, but, you know, a lot of people, just like as I read in that poem, they're not willing to go the extra mile. They're not willing to, especially when it ostracizes them to the mainstream. So many people are afraid to go against the majority in opinion, or to even study those things which are not endorsed by, you know, the mainstream and the Matrix and acceptable to the masses. And so for that reason, you know, there are few leaders and fewer yet that understand truth in the way it should be embraced. But go ahead.
Well, we get into these routines that, you know, that's a part of our life, like the church I used to attend, and I won't go back. I mean, I love the worship there, and I've thought, why don't I go back just to be a part of the worship? I don't want to be sucked back in, because what they do, they are gatekeepers, and they direct you to go in this path or that path. It's like I mentioned on a recent show where someone was trying to tell me they went to their church website to look up what they should think about the Book of Enoch, and gave me that, and they said, no, you should not read it. And, you know, that's what we encounter in our society, and so many people have that mindset where they will just go that path, and they don't realize that they are they are neck deep in the Matrix, and they have no idea that they're just allowing them to, that they're not thinking on their own. They're allowing the powers that be, the elite, ultimately, who I think, you know, is controlling this, Satan, they're allowing that mindset, that thought, whether they don't want to think about flat Earth, because, you know, science says, who is science? Right. You know, it's this person with the lab coat, you know, and you don't know who that is, except it's Bill Nye or Neil deGrasse Tyson. They're the faces. So that's what we live in.
Yeah, you know, last night I watched the movie God's Not Dead. It was fantastic. And
loved it.
Yeah, me too. And it reminds me, you know, like, the philosophy class, it's like what Christ said, the field is the world. And that's exactly the kind of thing that we're dealing with and we're contending with. It's all those people that will just sign off on a sheet of paper, God's not dead. God's dead, because they've been told to. They don't want to think for themselves. They want to just go along to get along.
They have their life to live. You know?
Yeah.
They don't want to
put themselves at risk, you know, whether great or whatever.
Got a girlfriend, you got a job, you know, I want to keep my car, I have to pay my mortgage. Mm-hmm. That's what, you know, and that's part of the plan to get us caught into this rat race.
Exactly.
I feel so much freer not relying on any of that in my life. And when I share this a lot, and it's from the late 70s, the Franco Zeffirelli movie about Yeshua called Jesus of Nazareth. And that, to me, I mean, it epitomizes, they're wearing rags and they are dropping everything and following Christ.
Right.
And that's how I want to live. That's how I want to think. You know, how can I be more like that? And, you know, all of my life I've spent doing the right thing. Look, I didn't even thought it's doing the right thing. What is that? Yeah, it's crazy. Follow Christ. That's the right thing. That's the eternal thing.
Yeah, that's my thing now, you know, because so many, it takes, we're groomed by our parents, culture, society, our friends, and all of their expectations to lead a certain life or to be a certain way, to even have our dreams and our goals and our what we should aspire with our life and our focus and all of that. Molded by those expectations. And most people, that's, you know, especially for girls, they want the Cinderella dream. They want the Prince Charming. They want to be a mother, a good housewife, you know, whatever. And then for men, it's like having a good job, making a bunch of money, and having all the nice toys. And anything outside of that mindset is foreign and not even thought about, not even considered. And when we start to really grow spiritually and we start to really seek kingdom and want to know the larger reasons for our being here and what all of this is about, life and being, then the spiritual, the inerrancy, as far as the inherent yearning to want to know about these larger aspects of who we are, why we're here, and what all of this really about. It challenges us, it forces us to acknowledge that maybe everything that we've taught is skewed or wrong or biased in some way that keeps us separated from God and keeps us separated from understanding the larger truths of life. And so really, in my opinion, it isn't until we start to disengage and break away from the Matrix and to challenge all that we have been brought up in indoctrination upon, that we really start to grow and that we really start to live in a way that brings us closer to understanding the secrets and also in having direct relationship with the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
You know, I was thinking this last week with the controversy and opening again with the serpent seed and your interview with Rob Skiba. You know how the KJV only people get real incensed about that. Well, I was thinking KJV scroll only. I couldn't imagine people in that day having closed their minds to knowledge or gnosis, you know, to understanding what was in their world. I think this is a newer phenomena. I don't really know the history behind it, but I imagine that there is this whole thing of shutting down discourse, you know, probably comes out of our educational system, our government school system, where children are taught what to think. I mean, they're programmed. And, you know, I didn't know that. I mean, I had a lot of problems more politically in the past, and now I understand things more fully. So, you know, I see this shutting down of things, and then it becomes kind of a herd thing, you know, like there'll be these posts on Facebook, and the first few comments will be really, you know, encouraging, and I hadn't thought of it that way, or I'll listen to that, and, you know, what you would expect in normal discourse with people, polite conversation. And then all of a sudden someone will come along, and it seems to me they have an agenda, because what I will see then is the same person, and then maybe like they're double teaming, and there's, you know, and maybe there's something going on there, or, you know, maybe someone really has a disagreement, but I don't see the kind of repeated thing, and it becomes like a feeding frenzy. And, you know, it's very dark. It's very dark, and there's a bad spirit about it. And I see that a lot in Facebook, but in this week I've seen it, and that's very unfortunate. And you've spent a lot of time very eloquently explaining. And I hope, you know, this is something I share with people too. In Facebook land, in YouTube land, where you have comments, Twitter land, when you put comments there, there are hundreds and sometimes thousands, and you don't know how many people who will see what you have written. And that is a witness to Christ, you Christian. Yes. And so the things that Zen will say, a lot of people will see that, and they will gain from that and learn from that, and maybe go and listen to the videos, buy a book, or just, you know, open their mind to the concepts or to other, you know, just be open, but they will see that. And the other, some of the really sad stuff that I was seeing that, they, you know, you can see that, you know what that is. And so I encourage people to be that way in their own witness in these social media environments that we live in today.
Yes, it is. It's an immortalized reflection of who we are. It gets locked into the internet, and it will be, as you said, looked at, revealed, studied by so many people that you'll never even meet, that you don't know who it will affect and who will it will essentially go out to. And I you know, that's why I actually took the time to respond to a lot of those individuals, more so than I usually do. I spent nothing but the past couple of days after the show that I did with Rob. And for those that don't know what I'm talking about, we did a show last Wednesday evening on his broadcast, where he invited me to speak about the serpent seed and the garden parable. And those of you that are familiar with both of our works, you know that he was highly opposed to it, as are most individuals, but he had never really investigated and examined it. And that's why when I sent him something about Cain not being in the blood lineage and in the generations, the genealogies of either Adam or Christ, it really piqued his interest. And so he did invite me to come and speak about it. And I thought that was very admirable of him, and I totally honor his open-mindedness and his willingness to listen and to investigate for himself. I just wish that more people would embrace that and follow in his example. And so that's why I really appreciated the opportunity. And, well, we set off a firestorm. And so that show, you can find it under Endeavor Freedom. It's Rob and I did a show on the Great Contest books 1 and 2, which are about the war in heaven, and also the Enmity Between the Seed-lines. And it was very respectful. Both of us were very respectful in talking about this as topic and issue. And it really resonated with a lot of his listeners, which, again, may not be open to some of what I talk about, especially with regard to this as topic. But we were able to speak about it and discuss it and share fellowship in manner that I think made more people courteous to and open to at least listening, which a lot of times they're not even, you know, they're not even, would they automatically, with judgment, bias, and condemnation, they're not willing to hear anything that I say and automatically shut me off and won't, you know, will automatically change the channel. But in doing that show, there, it has piqued a lot of interest for a lot of people. And it is also going to lead to, this Wednesday, we are going to do a follow-up discussion and actually a debate. Minister Dante Fortson, who wrote the book Serpent-Seed Debunked, and I will be coming on to Rob's show. He's going to be facilitating what will be a 2-hour dialogue on this as topic. And I think, you know, he is the perfect administrator for this, and that his show would be the perfect forum for Dante and I to get together and actually speak and answer the questions and to talk about these issue in a cordial manner. Because the show that I did with Dante previously, he wasn't open to it, and it was an immediately attack and, you know, cutting me off at every turn of the way. And so I'm hoping this will go a lot better, and that we'll actually be able to present it both sides, you know, because I'm interested in learning about why other people don't believe in serpent seed, and the, because it's evident to me, you know. But I, of course, I know I've studied this for a very long time, probably more so than most others here, and that I know a lot more about it than most people. Go ahead.
Some of the initial pushback, like I would see questions from people, what is the serpent seed? And I would see responses, it's from the Kabbalah. They don't understand it. And then they would say the origin is from the Talmud, or it's from some person. And none of that. I tried to respond that your research and Dr. Joy's were completely original and your own. And it actually is from Genesis, wouldn't it be? So it's really, that's a big stumbling block. They don't understand it's not from those sources. And also the targums, they don't understand the targums. And you explained that quite well.
Yeah, that was very important. And I was really glad also that Rob did a very eloquent post about his investigation of the targum, what they were, how they came about. Because basically, targum just means translation. And the Aramaic targum are the most ancient. They were the first authorized interpretations of the Hebrew Torah. And they were written for the Hebrew people themselves. And so for those that don't understand the background of where they came from, when the Babylonians took the Hebrew people into exile for 70 years, and they lived there for 70 years in assimilation, when they were allowed to return back to the Holy Land after the time of Darius and Cyrus in funding the rebuilding of the temple and allowing them to return, well, they had picked up as primary lexicon Aramaic. That's what the people of the region spoke. That was the predominant colloquial language of that particular region and that area of the world. And so Hebrew became mostly a scholarly language that was only able to be read and understood by the rabbinical, the priesthood. And so when they resumed worship in the Holy Temple, the priests found themselves always having to stop worship in order to translate the Hebrew Torah into Aramaic. And so that's when they authorized the translation, and this is the 5th to the 4th century B.C., after the rebuilding of the temple. And that's why they are the most widely recognized, well-respected, and renowned as far as in their interpretation of the Hebrew Torah being based upon it. And then even the Greek Septuagint, which was translated in the 3rd century B.C., they are also based on the same Hebrew and Aramaic manuscripts. And they are also what we would call Targum, which is simply translation. And then the King James, in the 1611 King James, which held 80 books initially, including the Apocrypha, they were based on the same Hebrew Aramaic scriptures that the Old Testament was based upon, the Hebrew and the Aramaic, and the New Testament was translated from the Greek, from the Septuagint, and then the Apocrypha was translated from the Greek and the Latin. And so they are also translations. And so, you know, most people, they don't understand what the Targums are, and they want to dismiss them because they think they contradict the King James. But essentially, they are more closer to the source, and they also not contradict, but help to clarify what is being spoken about. And that's the point of all that I'm trying to bring forth and sharing. And so I was really glad that Rob, you know, looked at it, investigated, and determined the same, took the same stance and presented it in the message that he did in the same way. And so hopefully people will be more apt to listening and then also in studying them, because in my opinion, they provide so much more detail than any of the modern translations, and they help us to understand the context of the Septuagint and the King James and other English translations in much better and concise manner, in my opinion.
Our brother Kenneth Beer says that the Bible is truth, but not all truth is in the Bible.
Right, so, right. Yeah. Also, you know, we've got just 4 minutes remaining. I want to let everybody know that whenever you are, if you are wanting to ever purchase any of our books at either Sacred Word Publishing or my own books at Lulu, that when you go there, if you click on the Lulu icon at the top left and then scroll down, they are always having sales and they change their coupons. And like this past St. Patrick's Day, there was a really good coupon. It was 27% off of all of the books that you purchase. And that was the coupon that I sent out, but it ran out at midnight. A lot of people did get a chance to use it. But the new coupon now is $5 off anything over $20 that you spend. And so that's pretty good. You can just, you know, if you order one and then order another one, just do individual orders, you'll get that 20% discount. But always just go and check there. They have really good, sometimes they offer a 15% discount and free shipping. And so if you're interested in our works, like I said, just go there to Lulu, click on the Lulu icon, go down, and they are always having some kind of a discount, some kind of a special. And so
there are books under the new store, our new publishing company, also Sacred Word Publishing. So those books, as well as your books.
Yes, and we'll actually, if you don't mind, Kathy, can you post the links in the chat room? And I'll also make them available in the show description. And I will be uploading sometime this evening the show that you and I did where we spoke about a lot of the different books. Yes.
And if anybody ever has any questions about it, just email me at paralandra77@gmail.com. That's P as in Paul, E-R-E-L-A-N-D-R-A, 77@gmail.com. I posted about it in every flat earth group I could find, Zen.
Oh, awesome. That's great. That hopefully drives some interest. But Also, anybody, those of you that are still learning and you have questions about serpent seed, we are going to have an open segment where we will be answering questions. So just send your questions either to myself to Rob, and we will address them, because the first three segments are going to be basically speaking about the different passages and scriptures that we would like to cover and show. And then, you know, we are going to have open Q&A. And so
there's a group. I think it's Resistance Rising. Is that the name of the group? Rob's group?
I'm not positive.
Well, where you can post the questions. If that's not it, email me and I'll correct on that. But I think you can go there and post the questions.
Excellent. And so please do come to the debate. I know it will be late night for a lot of people. It's midnight to 2 a.m.
Oh, boy.
You know, Eastern. So, yeah, drink lots of coffee or, you know. All right. But when we return, I'm going to be reading the Thracian Chronicles. This is going to be a fascinating text. I think y'all are going to like it. We'll be right back, everyone. All right. Welcome back, everybody. We do have an announcement for next Saturday. We've got a very interesting panel, and I'm very much looking forward to it. And Cathy, do you want to elaborate?
I'm very excited. We're going to have, and I'm going to say it, it's the Ladies of Flat Earth. I just think that suits us. We have Patricia Steer, who's joining us, Amy Denise, I don't know, but I'm excited to get to know, Carly Sunshine Medrano, and she has a YouTube channel. I've been following her for a while. She has a Facebook page called Flat and Happy. And also Amber Plaster, who is becoming known in the community. She's a singer. She did the Adele cover, and that was really exciting. Awesome. Yes. So they're all really excited about it. Carly and Amy are both going to be speakers featured at the International 2017 Flat Earth Conference in North Carolina this November. So
very cool.
Yes.
Yes. Patricia, too, right?
Yes.
Yes. Excellent.
Absolutely. She's really thrilled to be invited. So, I mean, it just came together. And I think I was really tickled about the idea of the four of them in a panel. And so we'll see where that goes. I have no idea yet what to do. I wish Patricia was hosting it. She does so great. So,
yeah, she does.
There's that pressure, but I don't feel any pressure at all. But you'll be there, too.
I'm just gonna, you know, like, I feel like I'm just gonna put on some pajamas and you know, kind of like a pajama party with the girls. I really feel honored to be able to share time and space with all of you.
Haven't been many of those. I mean, there's a real weight of men in the community that are more known. I mean, there are a lot of women in the background that are getting involved and doing different things, like myself, where I try and share information and, bring more people into the fold, for want of something better. After you've been doing it for a while, like we have, you have kind of a storehouse of where to go to look to find things and how to respond and you know, the entire universe of how, why, and what about Flat Earth. And so it's good to have that. And I think I know all these women do. And so it'll be real exciting. And plus Amber, I mean, she's a singer and very, she's just good. I love her vocals. I don't know how to describe it actually. Adele is,
wonderful voice.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Amber just did that so well. So such a great stylized with the words for, a Flat Earth take on it that, you know, a lot of people were saying, who's Adele? So anyway, I'm very excited.
Oh, also Linda asks if I'm going to be speaking at this conference. I will not be. I've already... I already had plans before I even knew that the conference was coming up. But I have been asked to join for the next year because, you know, they're going to be doing an annual event. And so I'll have a chance to get together with all of you next year. But Cathy will be there as liaison for Sacred Word Publishing, and she'll have a lot of incredible material. So, I do look forward to getting together with all of you when I can. But I'm looking forward to that panel, and I'm going to go ahead and get into this text. I feel that it will greatly bless your life. And then at the end, I'm hoping that Cathy and I will have some time to speak on some more of the, you know, just goings on as far as what's happening, since so many things are happening now, and so much is just, you know, with all the truth and the secrets and so much knowledge coming forth, it's just so difficult to keep up with. But anyways, a little background on the text I'm going to be covering, and I'm only going to be sharing six chapters this evening, chapters 13 through 19. It's from the Book of Navi, which is the Chronicles of Harbrazalmux. And it's from the Thracian, you know, of course, the Boheric master, noble, lords. It's a whole series of texts which are being worked on right now. And I actually just spoke with the people that I'm in fellowship with on this particular topic. And we're supposed to have a meeting very soon. They've been setting up a TV station to bring forth a lot of this information in Bulgaria. And so they've been busy. And so, but anyways, the details. It is known that Habrozalmux ruled in 386 to 383 BC, right after King Medoc Amadoc in 407 to 386 BC, and his paradynasty Sevet the Second, and before King Codus from 383 to 359 BC. From the Chronicles of Harbrazalmux, it becomes clear that he was not a real basileus, but a regent of the infant heirs to the throne, Perikshad and Amadoc. There are two transcripts in the Latin language, with the more comprehensive of the two included here. There exists also one fragmented transcript of a part of the text in the Greek language containing many Thracian words and also a few small fragments in the Thracian Boheric dialect. Again, this is going to be a fascinating text. The Latin transcript most probably dates to the period after the time of the Roman proconsul Marcus Crassus, when the Romans seized the sanctuary of Dionysus in the Rodolphe Mountains, 29 to 28 BC, and they plundered its library, where the chronicles were presumably held. And so these texts have been lost for a very long time. I'm also going to post a link into the chat room so that if you want to know more about where the book that it comes from, the Thracian script decoded, and how this is the oldest language in the world, and it was only recently in 2006 decrypted, which led to the translations of the Thracian Chronicles. You can read more there. And one other, I will post a link to where you can actually get the first book of the Thracian script decoded and read it for yourself. Most of it is in Bulgarian, but there is about 30 some pages in English, which are included into the text, which explain how they, well, basically, Dr. Guide and my friends, Zaveskin Gardisky, were able to crack the code on this language. And again, it's like the Dead Sea Scrolls or the Nag Hammadi Codices. It's a whole another collection of texts which are not available anywhere and which have been lost and that are now coming forth. And I hope that it blesses your life. All right, we're going to go ahead and and start. Chapter 13. I think it will. This is a fascinating tale. It says this. And in the Rhodope Mountains, from the sacred posterity of Meroeis, the priest of God, Dionysus, first you have to remember, let me break down the word Dionysus. Dion means God, and Isis, that is the Thracian translation for Yeshua. And so they're speaking about Yeshua as God, because again, they were Christians, they were believers, and they knew about the word coming into the world and how he would be born of the flesh, born of a virgin. He would die on a cross for the sins of the world and bring a forgiveness to everybody and a chance for salvation through him. And so just wanted to clarify that so you'll understand what they were involved in as far as their teachings and their religious practices. A remarkable boy was born of whom God had prophesied through the oracle in the temple long before his conception with the words, "A great son shall be born in Thrace, son of the mighty Orpheus, and son of the eternal covenant, and this boy shall bring about the rise and fall of many among the peoples, and he shall restore the divine covenant of his fathers to his people, the covenant which Rhesus broke and the descendants have forgotten. All shall listen to him, the tribes of Thrace, the people of Hellas, the Persians, the Egyptians, the tribes of Cilicia, Lydia, Pamplona, and even all the way to the Phoenician and Bactrian and India, and all of the animals on the earth and even the heavenly birds, and every tree and every stone shall answer to his call. For upon him my might shall rest, and he shall carry on my will. He shall glorify my name, the name of the god Dion of Thrace, Isis, the sun-giving, in all the land, and because of him, all the tribes shall once again speak of Orpheus." Now, when I say Orpheus, it's reference to Orpheus, who was actually a priest of the sun, of Isis. He was a believer, and he was a priest, and he taught in Thrace about the Godhead, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. As I share in one of the chapters in the book, The War in Heaven, where I share the first chapter, the complete first chapter of the Thracian book of Adam and Eve, which is not found in any of the other translations anywhere in the world. And it speaks about the coming of Christ, speaks about Jesus, Yeshua, and how they referenced him as Isis. I-S-U-S. All right, continuing. "And my covenant before the great day of our Lord. And when the boy was born, they called him Get, because he was kin of the Getae. And when he was 7 years old, and his father initiated him into the priesthood in the temple, he gave him the holy name Orpheus, because this is how it was prophesied about him, that he would be a great son of Orpheus. And this is how he was remembered for all time by the name Orpheus. And when he came of age, as it was by Thracian custom, Orpheus decided to head out and travel the wide world to accomplish feats for God and the people of Thrace, and to earn a fulgent, well-known name so that he can be a worthy keeper of his people. And when he was in the temple of Dionysus, Dion, again, God in Isis being Jesus, Yeshua, so the God Jesus or the God Yeshua, in Pere, and stood immersed in fast and prayer, seeking out God's will and guidance for his upcoming journey, lo and behold, a wondrous vision appeared before him. A white-headed sage was standing in front of him who said to him, Orpheus, I am your great-grandfather Thrax, whom you do not know. When I was your age, I headed out to walk the earth with my companions, to accomplish great feats and to earn a worthy name for myself, as you yourself intend to do as well. However, evil forces instigated the Acacians to sacrifice me to their gods so that they may bereave us from the holy posterity of our people and our name, not to be mentioned ever again among the tribes. But when they had placed me on the altar and had pressed their knife against my throat, a wondrous golden ram suddenly took my place. And when they sacrificed it, they thought they had put an end to the name Trax. And then the golden ram rose above the sacrificial flames and took me far away from the Acacians and carried me to many places, after which it left me in Colchis, where the bed of Phocis is. There stood a great temple of my God who had appeared before me in the image of the golden ram and had rescued me. And there in that temple lies to this day the golden fleece of the ram alongside the ark with my bones. I beseech thee in the name of the god of Thrace, bring my bones back to my birthplace, Peri in Thrace, and take with you as a reward the golden fleece which my bones are wrapped in within the ark. By doing so, you shall return the glory of Thrace and earn yourself a kingly name for all time. And when Orpheus was still in awe of what he had just seen, suddenly a radiant lamb, like it was of gold, faced him and spoke in human voice. Orpheus, son of the great Orphe, I am the god of your fathers, the sun-giving. Your forefather Orphe rejoiced in my word day and night. Do fulfill the request of old Trax and bring the ark with his bones back to the temple in Perae. For in the ark also lie three tablets of Orphe, which belong to your paternal home. Your guide shall be Azon, and he will return to you the throne of your forefathers, which by right belongs to whoever wields the secrets of the golden runes on the scrolls of lambskin written by the holy keepers of Thrace. I shall be by your side throughout your entire journey, and the spirits of the great holy men of ancient times will accompany you as well, for their hearts will find no peace until all ancient scriptures have been restored and brought to Perae. Arise now, belt yourself, and begin your journey, for your companions, both visible and not visible, await you to lead them to eternal and glorious deeds, for which all forthcoming generations will speak of. And while Orpheus was still gazing in the vision, he saw a tall white throne and four living creatures and many old men in front of it. And among them stood the same lamb, like it was slain from the beginning of the creation of the world, which had seven horns and seven eyes. And it came forth and approached the throne and took a great book from the right hand of he who was sitting in the throne. And when he took the book of the four living creatures, and the many old men fell to their knees before the lamb, whilst each and every one was holding a harp and a golden cup, and they began to sing a ode with the words, may blessing and honor, glory and sovereignty be unto he who sits in the throne, and unto the lamb forever and ever. And then the vision began to fade, and Orpheus found himself once again standing before the altar in the temple of God, Dionysus. Amazed by what he had seen, young Orpheus requested an audience with the oracle in Perae and told him all about the vision. Once you find your guide, tell him to come to me and I shall give him directions for your journey. The oracle briefly replied and bid him farewell. Orpheus immediately began asking around for someone with knowledge and experience who could guide him and his companions on a long trip, and promised a big sum of money to such a person, especially if he had the name Azon. Not many days passed, and an Achaean sailor named Yazon was brought to him who said that he is ready for such a task, if the pay was indeed handsome. Orpheus was immensely pleased with this because the Achaean sailors were quite famous for being very educated, skilled, and insightful people when it came to knowing about the wide world, and they quickly struck a bargain about the price. The following day, Orpheus sent him to the oracle in Pirae, as he and the oracle had agreed to do, so that he may receive directions for reaching their desired goal. Yazan returned to him, and he had written down everything the oracle had said. Now, this is an educated man, Orpheus said to himself. It seems that he is a literate Hellen. He can write, and he has understood and written down everything accurately and clearly. Yazan's notes read, "The oracle said the following. The destination can be reached only by sailing with Argo, a fast ship. Along the way, you must beware of the Heripi, King Kos, and the Amazon women. And to reach Kolheta, the Colchis, you must learn from Finn, who knows the bed of Phocis best, or the river of Phasis. And Lyki, he who gazes upon the gods, who has sealed the images to lead you. And once you reach Yet, Aya, the king of Colchis, you will have to defeat the bull, the man, and the golden dragon, and seek the help of the mighty Medea, the sorceress. If you find yourself in need, seek advice from Chiron, the centaur. This is how you will find the golden fleece of Trax. There I have spoken." "Sorry about the correction," said Yazan, "but the old man was mumbling, and I think that a lot of things are not clear to him. Also, regarding your man, I know that he is no longer named Trax, but Phrix, because he became a Phrygian, and that he has left Troy with many ships carrying big cargo and settled down in Colchis. I have been to Colchis, and I know many things about the way to it. We will need a very firm and fast ship, which I will try to acquire myself. But I need your promise that we will split the gold we find from the treasure equally, so that I may pay for the good crew from my share." And after they reached an agreement, Yazan swiftly spread the word among the local wealthy merchants that he is setting up sail towards Colchis to deliver an entire ship with golden hides from it, and was looking for others, which he quickly amassed everything in need for their entire trip. Soon after, he managed to acquire a decent ship, and he wrote the name Argo on it. He proudly summoned Orpheus, his companions, and the crew, which he had hired, to present it to them. They feasted the whole night through by Thracian custom and set sail east of Abadera in the morning. They sailed across the Thracian Sea, continued through the Hellespont, sailed across the Propontic Sea, continued through the Bosphorus, reached Salmonissus, and then headed north all the way to Mysia, after which again to the southeast along the coast of Bithynia, and then firmly to the east across Pontus. They wandered for a long time following the sea currents and winds, and although Yazan claimed to know the way to Colchis, they just could not reach their destination. They kept asking everyone about Trax or Phrix and about the golden fleece, but it seemed that no one had any knowledge on the matter. Everyone stared at them in wonder, and they saw work worn and burdened by their everyday problems and troubles people everywhere, fighting for their daily ration of bread and to survive until the next day, who were not only incapable of helping them reach their destination, but sought comfort and help from them. They also came across war and rumors of war in some places, which forced them to work their array around some towns in order to avoid being caught between the warring tribes. They had traveled to nearly every coastal city in Thrace and Hellas, but still could not figure out where the golden fleece was. Luckily, they had a lot of food and water and also silver coins, so that they were able to buy more provisions and continue their journey, which had now lasted several months. And although they aimed to sail near the coastline, they sometimes found themselves in rough waters and open sea, and fierce storms nearly sank their ship several times, but did not, thanks to the good crew which Yazan had hired. And when they had finally lost all hope of reaching the coveted Colchis on a wonderful sunny day, amidst calm and quiet waters, Orpheus and his companions entered the white outfall of a big river, which flowed into the distant East Pontic Sea. And when they landed in a suitable dock, they learned that they had reached Colchis, because this was the outfall of the river Phasis. They were all swept with indescribable joy, because it seemed that they had finally reached their destination. Once they set foot on the land, they were immediately surrounded by soldiers who asked them of their business there. And when the soldiers heard that they were sent by the king of Colchis, Ayat, they burst out in laughter, because there was no such king in Colchis, and they had never heard of one, not in the time of their fathers nor in the time of their grandfathers. But once they learned that Orpheus was the son of a priest and that Yazan was the son of a king, they showed proper honorable respect and hospitality, and the commander promised to send word of their arrival to Clistin, the king of Colchis. Once they spent several days in the inns and taverns and the docks, being taken round everywhere by the soldiers who had accompanied them, they were finally invited to the royal palace. All right, we'll be right back, everyone. All right, welcome back, everybody. Continuing. The king invited and treated them to a feast as a token of his hospitality, and proceeded to listen very carefully and patiently to the long tales of their journey and about their goal in the presence of his nobles. My honored and highly reputed guests, he finally said, your determination and bravery for undertaking such a long and perilous trip truly amazes me, and be sure that you have earned my respect and favor. I wish that my people and I could be of help in every way in order to assist you in finding what you seek. But alas, not my councilmen, who are all too wise, nor have I heard of this golden fleece, I not even of a famous traveler named Trax, or even Frix, who supposedly brought such a thing here, nor of him living in our lands for that matter. I do not want you to think that my people or I are somehow trying to hide something from you, which is here among us, or that we want to rob your people of Thrace and Hellas, for which we have always heard glorious words and which we highly respect and desire to be good neighbors of and to live in peace. And because you have traveled so far to reach us, and because we have many other wonders, even if they are not this golden fleece, please allow my nobles to take you to these places in my kingdom and be my guests for at least a month, so that you may travel everywhere and revel in everything which is glorious among my people, and also to personally make sure that we are not hiding the golden fleece from you here. And once you are well rested and have delighted us with your honorable presence, allow me to fill your ship with all necessary supplies of food, water, and clothing, and to send you off with the utmost ingenuous of good wishes to reach your destination and to have the protection of the gods, so that you may return home safe and sound. Orpheus, Yazan, and his companions happily accepted, not only because they were extremely exhausted and truly needed a long rest, but because they thought that the Golden Fleece might still be in Clestian's kingdom, even though he himself might not even know about it. Endless nights of feasting with never-ending food and drink at royal tables began, and young, gorgeous girls not only charmed and waited on the company of the guests, but also sheltered the most vigorous of them in their arms during the wondrous warm summer nights, in which talk of feats and love went hand in hand. The more enterprising of Argo's crew managed to display their exquisite goods from Hellas and Thrace on the city market, And soon, not only were they able to exchange them for equal and adequate number of exquisite and unique goods from the craftsmen of Colchis, but began receiving offers and orders involving no small number of gold and silver coin from the city merchants to bring even more of the same goods to Colchis. With soon, as a big part of Argo's crew and Orpheus's companions were so enthralled with what had happened to them that they had forgotten why they had actually came to Colchis and what was the initial goal of their trip. At the end of their 30-day stay, Orpheus and Yazan were absolutely stupefied to hear that more than half of their men did not intend to go back to their homelands just yet, but wanted to spend more time there in Colchis. Some of them, the more well-read and literate ones, said that they liked the splendor of the royal hospitality and had decided to accept Pleistothene's offer to stay in service to him in his royal retinue. Others had so strongly fallen in love with some of the women who sheltered them in their homes that they had decided to take them as their wives and invited Orpheus to stay for their weddings and bless their new homes and cultures where they would now stay and live forever. A third party had already established a successful business and opened their own street stands in the city markets, become partners with the merchants of Colchis, and promised Yazan and Orpheus that they would soon come to Hellas and Thrace for new goods with ships from Colchis, but that they could not return with Argo now because they would lose the biggest winnings of their lives. If we managed to amass so much silver and gold coin for less than a month, imagine what we could do if we worked harder. Your payment, Yazan, dares not match even the smallest of what we have already obtained here in Colchis. But the biggest surprise which was delivered to Orpheus was by Yazan himself, who called Orpheus to speak privately right before their embarkment to tell him, "Orpheus, you will not believe this, but I have found Medea, of whom the oracle in Perae spoke of. She is kin of the Medi. That is why the oracle called her Medea, although her real name is Aisha. She is a slave here in Kleistostein's domain, but she is the most beautiful woman I have ever seen. I fell in love with her and love her with all my heart, and she loves me very much as well. I told her everything about the Golden Fleece, and it turns out she knows about it too. She shared with me that she is the daughter of the king of Medea, and assured me that if I liberate her from her slavery and return her to her father's palace, he will thank me by giving me the Golden Fleece. We have journeyed so far. Don't you think that it would be worth it to kidnap her from Kleistostein's palace and go to her father, Medea?" Orpheus gave serious thought to what he had heard. What if this slave woman was willing to promise anything just to escape from her bonds? Was she really a daughter of a king, and has she really seen the Golden Fleece? This had to be carefully investigated straight from the source, her. Yazan introduced her to Orpheus, and Orpheus wished to speak with her privately. He questioned her about everything regarding the Golden Fleece. Aisha spoke in awe of Medea about the marvelous wonders and treasures the land possessed, and looked at Orpheus without even attempting to hide her admiration for him. With her dark, caressing, wet eyes, and carefully peered into his face, as if she was hoping to see the impact her words had on him from his expression. Wilt stop missing the opportunity to throw back her beautiful lock, to reveal her budding chest beneath her nearly transparent clothing? He questioned her about everything regarding the Golden Fleece. Whilst not missing the opportunity, nearly transparent clothes, her uncovered thighs were inviting him to stroke them, and she did not even attempt to hide them with her long dress. Orpheus shook his head and restrained his thoughts. "Tell me more about the Golden Fleece. Tell me of the runes you saw on it, and do you know their meaning?" he unexpectedly asked. The girl seemed disturbed for a moment and began to blink with the long eyelashes of her eyelids. "Runes? What do you mean? Oh, yes, the meaning of the fleece," she said, and turned her eyes to the side, quickly regaining her composure. "Yes, yes, the meaning of the fleece. It's very important. It is filled with gold and jewelry, pearls, and many different precious stones. What else?" you asked. There is so much gold that all of it weighs as much as an entire wagon filled with gold. With all the gold, whosoever possesses it will be able to buy anything they please and will have the freedom and luxury to live happily for the rest of their lives. If you take me there, I will forever be your faithful beloved, and you will be rich and happy with me and the fleece for the remainder of your days. When she said this, she threw herself into Orpheus's lap and began to passionately hug and kiss him, allowing her transparent garment to slip off entirely, revealing all of her beauty, and she was half naked in front of him. All right, Orpheus said, and carefully removed her from herself. Go now. I must think thoroughly to devise a plan for such an escape from Cleistocene's castle. If we are to go on such a long and dangerous journey, I shall discuss everything you told me with Yazan, and then I will make my final decision. But he has already decided and has given me his promise. He is just waiting for you to offer your support, Aisha said, covering herself with her garment on her way out of Orpheus's chamber. Yazan, I do not think your beloved is really a princess, Orpheus said to Yazan when they met after seeing her. A real princess would at least know how to read and write and would value those much more than what she could buy with a wagon filled with gold. I know that you love her and that is why you trust her completely, but I cannot risk the freedom and life of my companions for some woman's intrigues. Who can repay one's services only by fulfilling their lusty desires? I would advise against following her plans. Do not forget why we went on the long and difficult journey in the first place. The oracle never said that the fleece is in Medea. And besides, to go there, we would have to go by foot through paths and lands of which we know nothing. Both of us would wind up as slaves in the hands of a merciless master at best. Is it not best, as you yourself has written down, to ask Chiron the centaur? Did you not say that you have indeed heard of him? But Orpheus, how do you expect me to know where Chiron the centaur is? Do you not know that he is but a myth and may not even exist at all? How do you expect me to take you to him? I brought you to Medea herself. What more do you want? Yazan was very disappointed with Orpheus's lack of support, and stated that he will continue tracking down the Golden Fleece alone with Aisha, because he was sure he was following the Oracle's instructions by doing so, and that she, out of all the prophecies so far, was the only prophecy which came true and is pointing in the right direction towards the Fleece. They embraced in farewell, and the same night, after saying goodbye to Cleistocene and his nobles, Orpheus returned to Argo with the few remaining loyal to his mission companions. Orpheus didn't even get a wink of sleep throughout the entire night. Now where to? He unfolded Yazan's note with the oracle's instructions once again. He read and reread them again and again. Why couldn't he find King Ait? Was he not supposed to rule Colchis? Not some Cleistocenes? Was not the fleece supposed to be here in Colchis? What could he do now? Return to Thrace stripped of glory and amid his total failure? Could it be possible that the oracle's words mean something different? For example, Ait, a correction made by Yazan because the oracle had been mumbling. But the oracle had said Eat, and in the Thracian dialect of old, which the priest spoke in Perae, Eat meant the end, the endmost, the last. What if the king of Colchis was actually the endmost, the last king he had to reach to find out where the fleece is? Well, yes, but here he is, and he still does not know where the fleece is. What does it say next? The note read, and once you reach Eat, the king of Colchis, you will have to defeat the bull, the man, and the golden dragon, and seek the help of the mighty Matia. If you find yourself in need, seek advice from Chiron, the centaur. This is how you will find the golden fleece of Trax. There I have spoken. It did not even say a thing about some Medea, because that was a correction made by Yazan, but about Matia, nor did it say a thing about Chiron the centaur, but the name Chiron was actually pointed out. Obviously, Yazan had been following a false conjured up by him path, in which he had deceptively been leading all of them because of his own self-reliant and wayward corrections. Why did Orpheus see this just now? Why did he overtrust so blindly the Hellene and his overpraised knowledge and supposed extensive experience? Because of him, he had lost more than a half of his companions, almost the entire ship's crew, in a whole year in wandering journeys in unknown lands, which had brought him nowhere. Perhaps if he was to find this Chiron of whom the oracle spoke of and seek out advice from him, then maybe none of this would have been entirely for naught. In the morning, Orpheus got off the ship and went to the marketplace with several of his companions. They spent the entire day there asking salesmen, merchants, and passerbys if any of them had heard of a man named Chiron. It was at sunset when suddenly they came across a group of sailors led by a man named Semihil from a land called Hemi, where the greatest wonders of the world are the pyramids. Chiron, you say? Asked Semihil with a smile on his face. Why, Chiron means the priest of the godson in On. How would we not know this when we are from there and setting sail back to On, Heliopolis, the day after tomorrow? I can even take you to see him in person if you wish, because I have to personally deliver some goods he ordered. After 2 days, Argos set sail from Colchis, following the Egyptian Semihis fleet, and 4 weeks later, Orpheus and his companions were standing before the face of the priest of On in Heliopolis, who was named Sauzir, son of Orphe. We have been waiting for you to come for a long time, because it was prophesied that your path comes through On. You are looking for the secret book of Taigiti, the book of the God Word, the Word of God. Wow, that's interesting. And you have traveled the entire world to find it, but it was not where you sought it. However, we know of its whereabouts, for it is located where your great father Orphe was born, where the first Atamu was, and where the tree of knowledge of Thot and Re is. It is guarded by the ancient serpent, which attacks all who reach towards it so that they may not find salvation. For there upon it lies the eternal golden fleece of the God Word, he who sacrificed himself from the world's creation so that all who seek and find it may gain not only primordial divine knowledge and great wisdom, but eternal life within him. He is the Lamb of God, he who bears the sins of the world and comes forth to the world nailed to a piece of wood, for his fleece is laid upon the eternal tree so that all may eat from its fruit, namely the fruit from the tree of life, and when eating from it receive healing in its leaves, which are healing for the peoples. You are most welcome to learn with us as our fathers once learned with your holy father Orphe, O son of the great temple of God, Orphe. Forever journey towards the truth initially begin in spirit, and primarily there one must defeat the bull, the man, and the serpent so that the gates towards the tree of the knowledge of life may open. If you manage not in defeating the Heripi and the Amazons during your flight in the divine spirit, you shall not overpower them in sailing as well, regardless of how many years you wander across the world. But for you to defeat them, for you to be victorious and overcome everything and remain honorable and steadfast, you need at least a little bit of Matana. Namely, you must come to know the Maiden of Power, unto whom the Divine Spirit rests upon, whose sacred name is Mar-Re-Ye. Here among you will learn of the words of power and understand what Matana, the powerful speech, really means, so that you will not be stricken like your friend when he followed the slave girl Medea. Stay with us in the Temple of On until your training is complete, as it has been prophesied about you, in order for us to do all which is rightly by the covenant of the great Orphe, for we are all servants to the covenant. And after uttering these words of greeting, the priest of On welcomed Orpheus into the temple of On, where he lived and studied the secrets of Egypt for 3 whole years, until the time came for him to receive his priestly scepter and journey back to his homeland of Thrace, where according to the priests of On, the scrolls of Orphe, which were covered with the golden runes of the Lamb of God, he who comes into the world, were located. When Orpheus returned to the holy city of Pirae, he immediately went to see the oracle of Dion, Isis, Isis, who gave him the directions for his journey and told him all about his experiences in all the lands he ventured in. He also told him of his training in the Temple of On and about the Book of the Names and the speech of Matanu, in which all priests and ancient forces speak. The oracle asked him in return with his kind-hearted sweetness, "And what have you learned after all of this, my son?" Orpheus gave the following answer. "I learned that you were right when you warned us to watch out for the Hierapi, because in the ancient speech of creation, this means to watch out for eating and wine drinking. And sadly, many of my companions and crew failed to do so and abandoned me in Colchis. I also learned that you were right when you warned us about the Amazon women, too, which in the same ancient tongue means possessive woman, fornicatress, because women exactly of this sort possessed others of my comrades and made them abandon our mission, as did King Kos, namely the power of money, blinded many of my remaining comrades, and they too abandoned me for the sake of money making, which foreign lands had to offer. Furthermore, I learned that the king which I had reached in Colchis was not Eet, but Eet, meaning the final king of kings of the final farthest land which I had to reach. And this saved me from being misled by my guide Yazan and a slave girl into going further to the distant Medea. But I would never have found all of this out if it were not for my happy run-in with the merchant Simehi, for only he alone knew who Hieron, the person of whom you said I was to seek advice from, if I ever found myself in need, was. If it were not for Simehi, I would not have met Hieron, the priest of On, in Heliopolis, and even then I would not have been able to understand the meaning of a single one of the words you had spoken to me. It was only after my training with him that I was able to see that of the entire group, only I was able to overcome the will of the flesh embodied in the bull, which had thwarted many of my companions, and to overcome the weak, false human interpretations and arbitrary understandings which stirred a man like Yazan, and prevented him still from understanding your prophetical directions. Despite of his vast knowledge and intellectual abilities, and that I had been safeguarded from lust for gold, for pleasures and success, which hide within the lures of the wicked snake, which is the enemy of all followers of the true path of God. As you can see, I have learned a great deal of things, but there is only one thing I have not been able to understand, and failed to do so even to this very moment. And so let me ask thee, wisest of the wise, why, tell me, why did you have to speak to my God Yazan in so many foreign ways to him riddles, so that I had to sail across a multitude of seas and wander around a multitude of lands and lose many days, months, and even years of my life trying to reach the realization of such simple things, which you could have told me straight away with ordinary clear speech? Oh, my dear boy, were my words actually meant for Yazan? Was it not God who showed himself in the image of the Lamb of God in your vision and personally told you that your guide must be Azan, and that he will return the throne of your forefathers to you? You actually thought an Achaean named Yazan possessed the power to return the throne of your forefathers to you? Why did you follow a Hellene to lead you in the path towards the holy secrets of God? When have the Achaeans and the Danaans understood of something sacred in order for them to be your guide towards it? can a Helene really be mediator between you and the sacred things and the secrets of the divine ancient speech of Thrace? Were you rather not supposed to teach and enlighten him instead of him you? Never follow the Helenes in anything, because all their paths are led by the lust for women's flesh and gold and for power, and for perfidiousness of the snake has entangled them in all this like an unnavigable labyrinth. But you were supposed to follow Azon, namely your bright inner self, who is in the hand of your god, the god of Orphe, and the god of your fathers, the god of Thrace. The uttered words of prophecy were for your bright self, and if you had followed the meaning in your ancient father tongue, you would have done a lot better from the very start. For every sacred path and every sacred mission initially begin in spirit and not on some sailor's ship, regardless of how well educated and erudite he may be. For the wisdom and philosophy of man is torpidity and philosophy to God. There, it took you this much time to understand those which you now call simple things. But is finding oneself a simple thing? And does time spent looking for God's wisdom amount to time lost? And how can you call your wandering in foreign lands pointless, as if the experience gained from them means nothing? And if I did speak with simple words, as if I were talking to a simple man, of what worth would that have been to you? And would the prophecy of Orpheus studying in the land of Hemi with the priests of On, the Heliopolis, where the great word of Orphe was taught by the priest kings, come to pass? And without this, how were you to find the golden fleece of the divine word, and how were you to read its runes, which to this very day are upon the walls of the pyramids of Egypt? Unsearchable are God's ways, my child, and the wisdom reveals its riches only to the wise, and God himself tests the wisdom of all by observing them in their countless everyday thoughts and paths, even wanderings from the cradle all the way to the grave. And since you stand here led to me once more, you have come to continue down the glorious path and mission for which the Almighty has personally pre-known and approved and preordained you. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back, everybody. I'm going to try to move maybe a little bit faster to get through this, because I'd like to share some more commentary with Cathy at the end of the show. So I'm going to move. Now you may resume your training in the Temple of Peray so that you may reach the next stage of your initiation into the divine mysteries, those of Urim and Thummim, so that whatsoever you bind in heaven shall be bound on earth, and whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Only thus are you to find the golden fleece of Thrace and return it to be forever kept in Peray. And having resumed his training with the priests in Peray, Orpheus grew stronger in God's wisdom and power with each passing day, and he mastered the mysteries of calling and creation like none of the priests who had taught him had mastered them. For God had put in him an excellent measure of his spirit, and the divine grace rested upon him in great fullness. And when 2 years came to pass since his return to the holy city and the temple of God, Isis, the sun-giving, Orpheus once again stood before the oracle and confirmed that he is now ready to venture the path towards the fleece of the Lamb of God. You have understood the meaning of all directions in the prophecy, the oracle asked. Speak them, then. I think I have a part from one of them for which I am relying on your help, Master. Orpheus replied and began to list the secrets. I have learned from Finn, Master, as you yourself said, for Finn means the mouse in the ancient tongue, and the field mouse hides its treasures underground. It digs to reach the place where also the hidden treasures of the kings lie. Underground is also where the hidden golden fleece lies, and I myself must dig beneath the earth if I wish to find it. I also learned how deep I must dig deep enough to reach Kol Heta, namely the mud of the very beginning. For even when I was in Egypt, I learned from the priest that the older the treasure is, the deeper it is underground. And a treasure such as this, which is from the forefather of Thrace, Orphe, is surely to be buried within the deepest of buried things, namely in those depths of the mud which are most primordial and where there is nothing buried any deeper by man. And what the oldest thing buried by man is, I learned from Lik, for L-I-K means pot of clay. And since the prophecy states that Lik has sealed the images, it becomes clear that it is pots of clay with runes written on them. Regarding the bed of Phocis, I am now certain that it has nothing to do with the river Phasis, the same way Kohelia has nothing to do with Colchis. For Phocis means the pit, namely the pit dug out to the level of the primordial mud, precisely where such pots of clay with runes are buried. However, one thing remains unclear, and it is, where exactly am I to dig? Because the land of Thrace is too vast, and I cannot possibly dig through all of it. In the prophecy, you said that the destination can be reached only with Argo, and I now know that it is not the same as Argo, the fast ship, according to Yazan. I know the meaning of the word Argo in the ancient Thracian speech. It is, you speak. But who is the woman who is speaking? For we address only women in this manner. What is she supposed to be saying, whoever she is? I have not the slightest of clues, and it is apparent that without this final link in your riddle, I shall not succeed. Please tell me of its meaning. You think I know of its meaning, since it was I who spoke it? The old oracle replied. But not only do I not know what this link is telling us, I could not possibly reveal any of the secrets which you have uncovered. For even I could not break the seals of the revelation intended for you, even though I know the meaning of each and every one of these words individually, just as they are pronounced in the ancient speech of Thrace. Your bright self has led you to the interpretation which you are revealing to me now. For your bright self dwells within the cloud of the testimony of God's Spirit, which speaks to him. This is the radiant Rhea, the mother of all who live and of all secrets. She's the Holy Spirit, the soul of Thrace, the glory of God. She and she alone is speaking to you. She is also the same one who was speaking to the holy ancestors. She is teaching you to understand their tales and ancient secrets. Question every nook and corner throughout the land about the ancient tales which God's Spirit has spoken to the holy men, those tales which have been written down and which are sung only in the epodes of Thrace. And this same divine spirit, which is the author of them all, will show you where the golden fleece lies, and then you shall know where to dig. I, for one, would not have thought of digging, however, since the prophecy pertains to you. The divine spirit which led me towards speaking it to you, as it has been given to me, did not reveal this to me, but to you, my son. And that is the surest of signs that you are on the correct path. And God has seen fit to reveal the golden fleece of your forefathers to you as he willed to speak of it, all both to you and me. With God's blessing and with mine, walk onward and return soon, decorated in the crown of glory in the name of the great God of Thrace. God is with thee. From that day, Orpheus began to walk his homeland far and wide and collect every folk song and tell from all who remembered them and were the living memory of the people and the voice of the land of Thrace. And when he wrote them down in a book and began to sing them himself, Orpheus resurrected many of the holy ancestors' secrets and divulged and glorified them in his holy epodes, to which all listened to in awe. For they were in the ancient Thracian speech, which speaks to the soul and ordains the spirits. And well known was Orpheus's name, made to be as the greatest singer of all time, to which all of nature and all living and non-living flesh listened to. And he became brilliantly famous across the face of the entire earth. And singers and bards and singing priests from all lands came to him, so that they can learn from the ancient wisdom of the Orphic epodes. And he always kept asking of tales new and old coming from around the world through all of these voices of the people's memories, so that according to the tales, he can learn of the most ancient of wells and the wisdom of God, so that he may learn where the golden fleece is kept. And upon comparing all the tales of all the places with the world's most ancient of temples, behold, all signs pointed to the holy city of Noma in Thrace, where according to the oldest of epos, the great forefather Orpheus himself had laid the ark with the tablets of the divine covenant in the holy place of the consecrated ground of Pyrrhus, Noah's grandson. But when he approached the holy area, which the old men claimed to be Tyrus Noma, Orpheus saw nothing but a mere pile of collapsed stones and several hills, for the area had been without inhabitants for a very long time. And the fathers of those who had memory of the place claimed that the place is not to be treaded, for it had a divine prohibition cast upon it. This is how Orpheus knew that this was the place where the holy city of Noma once stood. And when he returned his gaze towards all the hills in his perspicacity, he saw those which were the doing of man's hands. And from one of the smaller hills, he heard whispers in the ancient speech, and the divine spirit showed him that this is the place he is to dig. He soon found the first pot of clay, and after digging up soil from deeper, he found fragments of earthen well on which the ancient runes could be clearly seen, just as the oracle of Perrae had foretold. Thus, Orpheus learned that he had reached the level of the Colchita, namely that soil which is from the time of the beginning, when Orpheus, the father, had laid the tablets of the divine covenant. After 8 months of time, Orpheus returned triumphant to the holy city of Perrae with 10 carts of priceless cargo, celebrating with these words, "I have found the golden fleece of Orpheus, the father, along with the 3 tablets, laying in the ark of which Trax spoke of in my vision. I did not find any bones in the ark, however, the bones of at least several souls laid beneath the earthenware, and I carried them as well, for they were near by the ark with the tablets and the might, and might belong to Trax. I have found many earthenware with ancient runes which had scrolls of lambskin written out with the runes of Orpheus on both sides inside of them. The lambskins was not of gold, nor were the runes. However, I believe that this is the golden fleece, for on some of the containers is depicted the Lamb of God in the branches of the tree in the center of the world, which is guarded by the snake, which is also depicted alongside it precisely as the Hieron of Egypt's words describe the golden fleece. And in one of the large containers with such runes was a golden rod wrapped in a scroll and golden beads and a golden tablet inside many others. Apart from all of those, I carry 5 chests full of clay tablets covered with runes, and 3 trunks contain tablets of bone also with runes like the former ones. There I bequeath all these treasures to God, the Dion, Isis, Isis, in his temple in Perrae. For they are rightfully his, for I have found them in Tyrus's Noma, where according to the tales of the epod stood the ancient consecrated ground in which Orpheus the father had laid the 3 tablets of the divine covenant for the first time, which according to song have been written by God's finger. And when he delivered the precious cargo which God himself had entrusted him to restore for the people of Thrace according to all he saw in the vision which God gave him before he set sail with the ship Argo, Orpheus fully devoted himself to the covenant of his God and remained in Perrae until the rest of his days, putting in order and preserving and safeguarding for all descendants of the great scrolls of the Golden Fleece, as was the name given to the library, written and compiled by the great forefathers of Thrace, Orpheus. And when the old oracle Perrae returned to his ancestors, Orpheus himself was appointed by the priests of Perrae to take his place and to speak the prophecies of the Lord. And thus it came to be, as the spoken words of the oracle had stated, since before Orpheus's birth, that a great son shall be born in Thrace, son of the mighty Orpheus, son of the eternal covenant. And this boy shall bring about the rise and fall of many among the people, and he shall restore the divine covenant of his forefathers to his people, the covenant which Rhesus broke and the descendants have forgotten. One day, as Orpheus the oracle was prophesying in the temple of God, Dion, Isis, and Pere, a royal son of the Hellenes, came to him with his retinue, seeking to ask God a Thrace about his own birthplace and hometown. Orpheus looked at him with kindness and said, "You are welcome before me once again, Yazan, for it seems that our paths crossed yet again." The silver-haired Yazan was moved to tears and said, "Indeed, friend of God, but this time you must be my guide. As I can see, you have undoubtedly found the golden fleece of your ancestors." Then Orpheus amicably replied, "Yes, sworn brother, I have found the fleece of the great Orpheus, but it was not golden. On it could be read the precious runes of the divine speech of grace. However, they too are not written in gold, as we once both thought. But it was well worth the effort, for God was and is in them. What about you, my friend? What have you found? Did the Median girl Aisha bring you to her father in Medea? For I see you are fully clothed in golden threaded wear." "Yes, Orpheus, she did. Although her father was no king, as you cleverly foresaw. Truly, I found no fleece with Orpheic symbols, but I found an awful lot of gold, much, much more golden talents than any fleece would weigh in gold, and this is why today I wear golden threaded clothes." Yazan replied, "Well, it would seem that your Medea has made you rich after all, Yazan." "Orpheus, well, you are mistaken, Oracle. I hope that the answers I seek from you amongst me being more accurate. For you see, it was not Medea who made me rich, but you, with your brilliantly famous name and our mutual campaign in search of the golden fleece with Argo. How you wonder? Not only you write and sing songs of the Stentorian priest, I have also written a song, a single song. And this song was about you, the great Orpheus, and about me, Yazan, and our mighty companions and the spirits of our glorious ancestors, which accompanied us about Argo and our glorious battles and triumphs over evil. Oh, Yazan, what battles, what glorious triumphs did we not meet with complete and utter failure? Orpheus scout, great friend of the gods, was I really to return to my homeland as a failure, as one who journeyed alongside the brilliantly famous Orpheus and failed? Do you not expect such disgrace to come on my part? I wrote the song which today is sung by big and small, from the reaches of the Ahia to the reaches of the Pythia and Parthia. A mighty song of how we vanquished the vicious harpies and rescued the prophet King Phineas, of how we battled with the warrior women Amazons, and how we tamed the sirens and storms of the sea with your magical voice, and how we vanquished the copper bulls of King Et and the warrior giants, which were born from dragon teeth, how we found the golden fleece in the branches of the old tree with the help of the Pisa, and how you, Centurion, subdued the snake of old, which was guardian of the tree, in order for us to obtain priceless, a gift from the gods. All of this and how we returned to our homeland triumphant. I have glorified forever in song and did not fail to tell you. I have ascended to the throne of my father in praise, where you sang in epos worthy only of the Olympic gods, our eternal feats for all the centuries. Oh, and believe it or not, I sang these songs my humble and companions in comparison to your voice before the entire world, before educated and simple, big and small, and all showered me everywhere with their generous gifts, for their hearts were yearning to hear such a song. And behold, it is because of this that today I stand and marry, and yet some dare to falsely claim that singing hearts. The credit is all yours, Orpheus, as is the glory for all time. So I beg of you to forgive me, for I do have made profit off the small favor of your great name. And if I have done wrong, please forgive me, for I did not. I did this from the purity of my heart, and only with the best intentions. And now I stand before you today, humble and kneeling down, and ask of you to intercede for me, my father's home, and my people with your glorious God, who we are in dire need of guidance and help. And when he heard Yazan's appeals to God, Dion, Isis, In his temple in Pyrrhe, Orpheus promised him to God and to step up before him. And when he stood before God in prayer throughout the entire of that night, around the ninth hour of the day, the sun-giving God, Jesus, word, revealed himself to him in a shining vision, and Orpheus spoke to him thus, "O omnipresent Lord, behold, your servant stands before you, and my heart is filled with much sorrow, and my youthful immaturity and lack of faith. Now such false people about you and great, which came to us through your anointed Orpheus, our son, about the time. There, because out of the goodness yet unapprehensive of us, his uninitiated Hellenes heart, he has made out of your truth the mere myth, which glorifies human vanity and pain."
Sin?
Those do not know. Yes.
You're cutting out a bit. I don't know what's... Is it your mic? Oh,
sorry.
That's good.
Maybe I was going too fast.
That's good.
All right. This is the last portion. "Tell me what I had to do to correct this evil and not have you count iniquity unto this old friend of mine who comes to seek mercy from you despite him not knowing you." Then the Lamb of God replied to him thus, "Orpheus, son of Orpheus, look benevolently upon your childhood friend. For how can a wise man such as yourself be angry at the childish ignorance innate in all Hellenes to this Hellene? And why do you deem the epodes which he has written as false? Do you not know that all truth throws a shade of its own likeness, and that every mystery for the initiated has its own retold parable, meant for the simple-hearted and the uneducated, undedicated? So does this myth not state correctly that you prevailed over the Haripi and the Amazons? Did you not vanquish the covering cherub in the tree in his three faces, that of a bull, of a man-giant, and then of a dragon? Did you not indeed find the way towards the golden fleece with the help of the divine speech, Matura, in the temple of the Hieron in Heliopolis? Do you not understand that all must be spoken in parable for the outsiders, so that in listening they hear not, and in looking they see not, and in thinking they reason not? For the secrets of the kingdom of heaven are for the insiders. For unto you that in listening they, the insiders and the devoted to God who follow me to the end, ears which hear and eyes which see and hearts which reason have been bestowed, but unto the outsider it is not so. Thus, when the Son of God arrives in the world, many will gaze upon him and not see him, listen to him and not hear him, and walk in the wake of those who follow him, but not truly following him, for they will not recognize him. For he will be sent to a people who will not recognize him and will not glorify him, but hang him on a tree and betray him to be killed. And all will happen thus in order to reach what comes to pass about all that is written about him. But woe unto the men who betray him, and woe unto the people amidst whom he will come, but they shall not recognize. Always and everywhere pray to recognize him when he comes in his glory, and to not be among the infidels which will hang him on a tree. For their sin will remain forever, and only a few of them by God's mercy shall be saved. And to Yazan speak thusly, my God says that, go with peace and you shall be blessed, you and your father's home, for you had little power and little knowledge, but have acted honestly and with goodwill towards Orpheus and his paternal home. And from now on and until the end of times, your song shall be my parable for all peoples, for the glory of my servant Orpheus and my chosen people, track, go with peace. And Orpheus continued to serve God and the people of Thrace until the rest of his days, and accomplished many other great deeds, which are written in the books of the Thracian Navi and are kept in the temple of Pyrrhe to this day. He restored the Orphic covenant of the one God with the people of Thrace, and restored the mysteries of the temple. And his disciple Midas reestablished them in Eleusis and Phrygia, where they had ceased for centuries. And his glory had spread to all the tribes of Thrace, and to the people of Hellas and the Persians, and the Egyptians, and the tribes of Cilicia, Lydia, and Pamplona. and even all the way to Phoenicia, Bactria, and India. And he was brilliantly famous among all the peoples, as it was foretold about him, since he was still in his mother's womb. And before he returned to his forefathers in Thrace above, Orpheus swore the priests and kings of Thrace to always and everywhere remind the nation and its peoples to be mindful and see the time when the Son of God, the sun-giving Isis, Isis, will come to the earth, and to accept him as it is fit for a son of God, and to believe in him, and for woe unto the people to whom he comes and neither recognize him nor accept him according to the given prophecies. Last two sentences. And he predicted to them that this is the Savior who comes unto the world and sacrifices himself as a Lamb of God for absolution of the sins of all men everywhere. And when he fell asleep, Orpheus returned to his fathers and to his forefather, Orphi. What did you think about that, Kathy?
Oh, it's stunning. It's absolutely amazing. I was reading at the beginning what Stephen Guide had written about the text, about it being the dawn. It's about the dawn of human civilization. It reflects the story of the oldest civilization known in Europe. Sensational discovery about the oldest known inhabitants of ancient Europe. I mean, this is a historical text that predates the Sumerians. It predates, you know,
1500 years, 2000.
Yes. Yes. So, you know, that stuff is following on where people are so adamant about the Sumerians being, you know, before Christianity. We're reading about Christ in this. Right. That's amazing. It's everything.
Yeah, it really is. And it shows.
And, I noticed they refer to the Holy Spirit as she.
Exactly. Yes. Exactly like I revealed not long ago and wrote about in my book, The War in Heaven. Yeah. Exactly.
And I'll push my book again, Worship of the Serpent. Thank you, Reverend Dean. He wrote it.
Beautiful.
But I edited it. The snake's all there again. I mean, it's everywhere.
Yeah. You know, I spent all day reading about that yesterday. But one final comment with regard to the Thracian Chronicles. It shows you that, you know, them being the oldest people post-flood, which is why he had to dig down to get all of these old teachings that were buried in the flood, you know, the deluge of Noah's day, that they were Christians and they were part of the children of Noah, the grandson of Noah, that they were part of those that worship and knew about the coming of Christ. As we showed in the Testament of the 12 Patriarchs in the show that I did with David Carrico, it verifies and absolutely confirms that the biblical narrative and the teachings, the prophecies, are not based upon the pagan Sumerian cuneiform stories and the ancient Egyptian, you know, because they worshipped a pantheon of gods and goddesses, and even though they knew about, which is why it's reflected in their mythologies, like in the, you know, Horus, and some of them, while they claim to have been virgin births, and they are counterfeiting and stealing the stories of Christ, our Savior Messiah. God bless all. Good night.
God bless you. Thank you so much, Zen.
Thank you, sister. Always an honor.
Okay, good night. Don't forget Wednesday debate time.
Rob, Revolution Radio. Join us then. Be blessed all. Good night.